is the best thing I've ever done. Hallelujah. We invite you to come to our Zoom. The link is in the chat. Hallelujah. For those of you who are on Clubhouse. And we're just going to have a time in the Lord. Hallelujah. I believe that God wants to do some things in you and I. And that we're going to be studying the holiness movement. We're going to continue from last week. We're going to conclude that study. And we're going to be talking about the tenets of Christianity. Many people know that they have faith, but they don't understand the tenets of the faith of Christianity. Hallelujah. And it, as disciples, we need to know. There's a great song by Dawkins and Dawkins, Need to Know. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. We praise God. Thank God for you, you and you this evening. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Father, even now, in the name of Jesus, Lord, come on in the room. Have free course right now. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for what you're about to do in the room right now. We give glory unto you right now. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, my Savior. Praise the name of the Lord. Oh, yes. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord God. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. We give God the glory for what he's doing in our lives. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus. We come before you in the mighty name of your Son, Lord Jesus Christ. Father, you promised us when we would come in that day, we would in no wise be made ashamed. Hallelujah. Lord, we give glory unto your holy name. Lord, we thank you. Thank you, Jesus, for what you're about to do in us right now. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we have come just to say thank you. Lord, we have come just to say praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Father, we have come just once again to study and show ourselves approved unto you, Lord God. Workmen that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Thank you, my Savior. Hallelujah. Thank you. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Oh, my God. Thank you, my Lord. Lord, give you glory, give you praise. Father, have your way in us right now. Not unto us, but unto you only. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. Thank you. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord God, thank you. Father, as we have come, according to your word, which is the study that shows ourselves approved unto you, Lord, workmen that need not be ashamed, rightly divided the word of truth. Lord, let the words of my mouth and meditations of my heart be accepted one last time. our rock and our salvation, Lord. Lord, thank you for what you're about to do in our lives. Thank you, Lord God, for the peace of God, which transcends all understanding. Thank you, Lord God. Lord, we invite you. Invite your presence and power of the Holy Spirit. Spirit of the living God, we give you the glory. Thank you. Thank you. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Most high, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and they are safe. Praise the name of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory be to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. Praise the name of God. Hallelujah. Totara Bokosha, Tara, the Oroshon, Tara, the Nikoroshin, Tara. Father, right now, bless everyone that comes in the room. Bless Mother Apostle Denations, Apostle Dr. Kadeem Simone Hinson. Bless Minister Frank G. Hinson. Elders Alana, Isaiah, and Micah Hinson. Bless in a mighty way right now. In the name of Jesus, Lord, I give glory unto you. I give you praise, for you are worthy to be praised. You are worthy of all honor. Hallelujah. As we go into and delve into the history of Christianity and into the ministry of knowing the tenets of faith as disciples, knowing our spiritual ranking, Lord, in you. Father, I thank you. Hallelujah. 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 So might we give the glory and praise. Thank you for your anointing. By Satan, principalities, powers, the rules of the darkness of this world, spiritual wickedness in high places, in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we loose the spirit of intercession, and Lord, we intercede on behalf of all men for kings and all who are in positions of authority, that we might lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and verity, Lord God. For it is not your will that any man should perish, but that all should come into the knowledge of the truth, and the truth is in Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, my Lord and Savior. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 So, in Jesus' name, amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Once again, my name is Apostle Sean Sterling Simpson. Hallelujah. Administrator, instructor, teacher, coach here at God's Lighthouse Tabernacle International Ministries. Hallelujah. We give glory unto God for you. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Thank God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, my Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Glory be to the Lamb of God, which was slain before the foundation of the world. Why is he giving praise before he teaches? Well, let me tell you something. The Holy Spirit is the teacher and the preacher. And I must decrease so he may increase. Let it be none of me, but all of him. Hallelujah. we was dealing with some of the history of the holiness movement, where it got its start, who were some of the people, like Jonathan Edwards, who preached a sermon called Sinners in the Hand of an Angry God. And the anointing that was in that message, because all he did was read it. The anointing that was in that message caused people to repent. The whole church was weeping tears of repentance. He brought godly sorrow and it led to repentance, and people were crying out unto the Lord. We talked about, hallelujah, John and Charles Wesley in the 1800s, and people who really understand the holiness movement, what was going on. Now we're gonna go in some of the churches that were started because of the holiness movement, and we're gonna get into a look at them, and then we're gonna go into the tenets of Christianity. Amen. Amen. It says the doctrine versus experience. The early church went into its dark ages because men became, again, our text is the eternal church, a Dr. Bill Hayman, hallelujah, a prophetic look at the church, her history, restoration, and destiny. Hallelujah. It says, hallelujah. The early church went into its dark ages because men became more interested in doctrine than experience. You need to add, yes, nothing wrong with having doctrine. Good doctrine. You got to be sound in the word. But you got to experience the Lord for yourself. Experiencing Jesus. Henry Blackaby wrote a book about that some years ago. I think a couple of decades ago. And what are you saying when you say experience Jesus? Well, to experience Jesus, you must realize that it is not because of anything that you or I have done. It's because of what he has done. And I really want to say these things about this. And you and me. The Bible says, with holiness without no man, all will see the Lord. So, yes, there is a place of separation from the world. Separation, which means consecration, which means sanctification. A life set apart unto God. Your life is no longer your own. You live a life separate unto God. So let's go. Let's delve a little bit. More, man does not like to be subjected to the foolishness of God, even though it is wiser than the wisdom of men. 1 Corinthians 1:25. The natural man tries to know God by intellectualism, human reasoning, and theological discourse. Now, I'm not knocking that because I love to get theological. I love to exegete texts. I love to get the hermeneutics of what's being stated. But, and which is proper biblical interpretation. But I really want you to understand is that if you do not experience God for yourself, all you have is a bunch of information from people. But if you, yes, you will need to know why you believe and what you believe, but you must know Jesus for yourself. You must have an intimate relationship with him, intimate fellowship with him. You need to, the Hebrew word for intimacy is yada. Yada. And we need to yada the Lord. Give him a big hug, a big kiss. And just say, thank you. I might preach a little bit, sound a little preachy this evening, but it's only because of what he has done. Hallelujah. That helps explain why the proud, sophisticated, conservative, religious people were appalled by the demonstrative emotionalism of holiness saints. Remember that the original church, the body of Christ, was birthed not in doctrine, but in supernatural experience, accompanied by physical and emotional demonstrations that caused onlookers to think the followers of Christ were drunk. What dead Christian religious denominations call dignified, God calls petrified, and sometimes putrefied. Oh my God. Stiff and stinking. When you just put the Holy Spirit all the way to the back, that grieves him. Be instructed before he comes from. The Bible says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God. Let's go a little bit further. Doctrine and order is necessary and scriptural, but not to the exclusion of experiential and emotional worship. I'm sorry. I'm not just going to look at the preacher and let him teach and not say amen and not say preach, preacher. And not lift my hands in worship to the Lord when I'm praising God. There's something wrong when people don't want to dance to the Lord. To praise the Lord in the dance, to praise the Lord with a shout, to praise the Lord with the on music of 10 strings, my God. On the drums with sound of the horns. You wonder why I love to hear the sound of a saxophone? Because the way it's played, the melody that comes from it is so beautiful that it makes, without it, all I'm hearing is clanging cymbals. Because to me, the saxophone is an instrument of love. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Doctrine is the wood of the church, but divine emotion and zeal is the fire. Doctrine is the mind of the church, but experience is its heart. The Bible says that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. The word of our testimony is what? Our experience with the Lord. Our personal experiences with the Lord. What he has done personally in our lives. And I have many. I have many. Hallelujah. When Christian denominations ban all emotion and demonstration from the church service, they retain a form of godliness but deny its power. 2 Timothy 3:5. Sad to say, every Christian denomination established during the last 450 years of the church's restoration lost the life and reality in which it was birthed by the second and third generation of descendants. That is sad. Listen, if you're too good to lift your hands to the Lord, you're too good to clap your hands, you're good, too good to shout hallelujah, glory to God, then something is wrong. Something is wrong. Well, it just doesn't look dignified. The Bible says that David danced so hard before the Lord that he literally danced out of his clothes. Stop being dead. Give the Lord some praise. Because I don't want no rocks crying out for me. I'm not the frozen chosen. I got a fire in my belly. comes from knowing him for myself. The section doctrine of Christ's faith toward God. Now we're using Hebrews 6, 1 through 2 as our background scripture. I need to read that real fast. Hallelujah. Hebrews chapter 6, verses 1 through 2. Now the Lord is not going to make coffee and tea for you. Unless you know, unless you really need it. I'm not going to put anything past the Lord for what he can do. Hallelujah. Hebrews chapter 6, verses 1 and 2, out of the King James says, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God, of the doctrine of baptisms, and of laying on of hands, and of resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment. And this we will do if God permit. If God permit. Let's go a little further. Faith toward God was the second doctrine of Christ to be reestablished in the church as a functioning truth. Faith working through love, Galatians 5 and 6, is the basic and ultimate essence of Christianity. Without faith, it is impossible to please him, Hebrews 11, 6. Every blessing derived from heaven by humanity is by faith. God shows no partiality, according to Acts chapter 10, verse 34. His blessings are dispensed on the basis of faith and obedience to his truth. Faith is the medium of exchange for heavenly blessings, as money is the medium of exchange for earthly things. What's in your account? You should have a spiritual bank account, which is what? Using the measure of faith that God has given to each one of us. Then, and only then, can we do what is necessary for us to do. Praise the name of the Lord. Every restorational truth will be established in the church and received by members as they have faith for it. However, God is the author and finisher of our faith, Hebrews 12 and 2. The Holy Spirit inspires faith to believe and receive when it is time for the fulfillment of another truth. Members of the body of Christ are responsible for responding to the Holy Spirit to be teachable and changeable, but not gullible or unstable, to be open to a new truth, yet proving all things with scripture. Nobody said throw away the Bible. Because if you throw away the Bible, what you're going to have sooner or later is some heresy or some cultish behavior. If they tell you not to speak with your family, that's a cult. If they tell you, don't go visit no other church, because we only got the truth here, that's a cult. And holding fast, I'm going to read that sentence again. Members of the body of Christ are responsible for responding to the Holy Spirit to be teachable and changeable, but not gullible or unstable, to be open to new truth. What is the Lord? Let me make a statement. Yet proving all things with scripture and holding fast to that which is good, believing and receiving new truth, but not being deceived, proud, or presumptuous. The Bible says in the book of Ephesians chapter 4 that we henceforth be no more children trick with every wind of doctrine. Oh, there's a prophetic conference going on. I got to be there. Now, I'm not saying that it's not a move of God going on in that, in the prophetic conference. But what I am saying is that you cannot tell me that you are doing a work of faith by not going, getting it first from your local church, from your local pastor, the one who is with you every Sunday. Because guess what? That prophet or apostle or evangelist probably is gone somewhere to the next venue. So you what you get from the week that you've gotten, you probably already heard your pastor or bishop say, and guess what? You be like, oh, that's what they were talking about. Yeah! But you couldn't receive it because why? The Bible says no prophet hath any honor in his own time. Jesus said that. True movements also spawn counterfeits. Now, this is why you need the gift of discerning of spirits. You need some discernment. Now, watch this. Every restorational movement has had its preachers who have gone into erroneous teachings. Every movement has established mainline churches that maintain the truth that the Holy Spirit restored to the church. However, each movement have also spawned false cults, a diversion of the truth sufficient to destroy its members' true spiritual life. We got cults out here. Let me talk to the Black community. You got bricks out here, Black religious identity cults, Nation of Islam, 5% Nation of Gods and Earths. The Zulu Nation. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Oh yeah, y'all. I might not know who the Zulu Nation, but I guarantee you, if I play Planet Rock, you know it. Party people, can y'all get funky? But yeah, I bet you know it now. Now, don't get me wrong. African Man Battle and the Soul Sonic Force. Actually, when you listen to their song, there's nothing in that song that is blasphemous or anything. But I'm trying to tell you, you got to protect what you hear. You got to protect your eyes and what you see, because it is the truth. The eyes are our window to the soul. The ears, because guess what? What you see and hear gets into your spirit, into your mind. And then what happens? Somehow or another, you done built a stronghold up against what the Lord has been trying to teach you. By what? By the Holy Spirit, who is God. Praise the name of the Lord. Mm. Because of those who pervert the restored truth, sometimes onlookers are discouraged from participating in. In every genuine move of God, Satan has often sought to pervert what God was doing to make the truth unpalatable to the true people of God. There can be no such thing as a counterfeit unless there is a genuine article. A person who has been discouraged by a counterfeit will find that there has to be something real from which the counterfeit was produced. The truth becomes neutralized. History has proven that the mainline restorational churches that retain the truth do not usually go into the error. However, often they allow the truth to become neutralized by denominational tradition. Well, if it was done this way in 1950, it's good enough for me. We in 2023. That's 73 years ago. I'm not saying we don't retain the truths that were taught in 1950. But we have to hear what thus saith the Lord to us today. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Praise the name of the Lord. They formalize the truth into creeds without the life-giving flows of the Holy Spirit. Well, I used to hear about folk hanging up wheelchairs and crutches and things. But guess what? The Lord is still doing it. You have to grow up. You have to have sound doctrine plus the experiential move of the Holy Spirit. So when you have that working together, the word and the spirit in agreement, you have the anointing which will destroy yokes coming off the saints. And sinners will come in and say, what must I do to be saved? In retaining the doctrine, they forget the doing. The verbal expression is there without the heart experience, a form of godliness, but not power, not the power of God that originally accompanied that restoration of truth. I need it all. I need the word and spirit. I need the move of God. And I need the word of God. I need the Bible. Because the Bible gives me sound doctrine. But I also need these restorational truths to be shown in practice. You have to practice them. Let's go a little further. Such became the condition of many of the Lutheran, Episcopal, and Presbyterian churches. They had fought so hard to be separated from all religious dead works and paraphernalia that they eventually went to extremes in faith only. Sola fide is the Latin. After Luther and the other original Protestant reformers had gone to heaven, second and third generation churches were trained in their denominational colleges. They were taught the doctrines without the original restoration reality. By the time the Holiness Movement came into full force, many of the historic Protestant churches had deteriorated to the point of promoting a mental faith without a heart and life change. It's not just a mental assessment that Jesus is Lord. No, it's got to be from the heart. It's got to be a... When we sing, oh, what a change in my life. Something on the inside, working on the outside. Oh, what a change in my life. What are you saying, preacher? I'm saying that you got to have the Holy Ghost. And I said it right, too. Capital H-O-L-Y, capital G-H-O-S, apostrophe, Holy Ghost. You need a dose of the Holy Ghost. You need some medicine. You need to go to the doctor. His name is Jesus Christ. Woo, hallelujah. The faith toward God doctrine not only restores new faith, true faith that produces a living experience, not just a mental acknowledgement of a scriptural truth, but reactivated the truth of justification by faith back to its original reality. Faith toward God restored the faith of experience of believers. Baptism by immersion, the faith experience of sanctification of the soul, victorious living over worldly and fleshly things. The faith experience of a baptism in Christ's presence, love and reality. The faith experience of discipleship and of the Lord Jesus, Lordship of Jesus Christ. The faith experience of divine healing for all the physical health needs of the body. It was essential that these faith experiences be restored and reestablished in the church. Just as a building must have a foundation and walls before it can be completed, the restoration of truth was necessary before the greater growth, maturity, and full restoration could be obtained for the one eternal body of Christ that it predestinated for the ultimate perfection. Holiness Movement churches. Literally hundreds of separate churches, church groups were established during the Holiness Movement. Most of them became a Christian denomination. Some developed into mainline restorational churches. Some went into fanaticism, others into cults. Brief histories will be given of the Baptist denomination to represent the Christian denominations that originated from believers' baptism by immersion, of the Methodist denomination to represent the churches established from sanctification, and of the Missionary Alliance denomination to represent churches that established from teachings on divine faith healing. Baptists. Baptists are mentioned first because they represent the first phase of the holiness movement. Believers by baptism by immersion. There are 10 major Baptist denominations in the United States, and as well as many numerous small groups. The Handbook of Denominations by Frank Esme uses 25 pages to briefly mention some of the major and minor Baptist groups. Present day Baptist groups evolved from the Puritan and Anabaptist movements in Europe to the Separatists and Independents of England to the General and Particular Baptists. The first particular British church dates back to 1638. The Particular Baptists were more fundamental, holding strongly to Calvinistic views. The General Baptists were more liberal in their doctrine, and a portion of them evolved into the Unitarian Church. Roger Williams came to America in 1631 and became the chaplain for the cause of Baptist beliefs and in the early days of colonial America, especially those of separation of church and state. Let me help y'all. I was raised in the Baptist church from boyhood. Now, what is that stating? Listen, I know everything the Baptist church is going to do. Sunday morning, they're going to have Sunday school. It's generally from 9:30 to 10:45. You get a little 15-minute break to take care of what you need. Your personal needs. 11 o'clock, guess what? Devotions, the deacon's gonna start devotion, which means they're gonna read the scripture, they're gonna sing a couple of songs and pray. They say, we thank you for joining us in this short devotion. And then they're gonna turn it over to the pulpit. And that generally starts the march of the choir. The choir march in, hallelujah. And some of them be singing, "We Come This Far by Faith." Some of them be singing, "Oh, Happy Day." Some of them will be singing, "Amazing Grace." But I'm telling you, I know. And then whoever is the moderator for the day, that associate minister who's the moderator, unless they are the one preaching, someone will moderate. That means he will get up, he will do the welcome. I'm saying he, because most of the Baptist churches have male ministers. Now, some are bringing in women who are ministers as well. So I don't want you to think that the Baptist church is misogynistic. But when I was growing up, as a little boy, we went to Union Second Baptist Church, where the pastor was the late, great Dr. E.C. Copeland. And with Dr. Copeland, he would teach, and he would teach so well, he would preach as well. Someday, but when he would teach, and he would pass by me and on the car and wave to me, and I'm like, "Hey, pastor." And I was shocked who he knew he was. I said, "Oh, yeah, you Mother Simpson's grandson." He knew my family. He would preach, and there would be a Mother Mamie. She would be up in there, and she would be shouting, "Hallelujah! Woo!" Yes, contrary to public opinion, Baptists do shout. All right. Then there would be some prayer, there'd be some singing, there'd be two collections. One would be for the Missionary Benevolent Fund. And the second collection would be for tithes and offerings. Then what Pastor Copeland would do, he would preach the gospel. And I remember I was 12 years old, and it was time for me to be baptized. It was January 1st. My grandmother, she was a PK Baptist all her life. Married a Methodist man, my grandfather. And I just got to tell you, what a blessing. What a blessing. My grandmother was a praying woman. My grandmother read her Bible. And I know because she raised me between the ages of 7 and 15. And between 7 and 15, I would watch her at 7 o'clock every day go into the den, shut the door. She would do three things. She would call my great-grandmother. She would pray and read her Bible. And woe to you if you disturbed her, because guess what? The rod of correction was coming, and I was the one who mainly caught it. Hallelujah. Roger Williams and John Clark established the first Baptist churches in America at Providence and Newport, Rhode Island in the late 1630s. The Baptists had many debates concerning Calvinism and Arminianism, and to this day, that argument is still being had. Calvinism prevailed and became the theological standard of many, if not most, Baptists in America today. In the mid-1700s, during the revivals of George Whitefield and John Wesley, another controversy arose among the Baptists. The division was between the old lights, or regulars, who distrusted revivals and emotionalism, and the new lights, or shepherds, who demanded a reborn membership in their churches. Back in the days, it was called the mourner's bitch. Oh yeah, you weren't getting in the church unless you was on that morning, and you knew that you had a spiritual experience with God. Then the people, you give your testimony, and that's how it was. That's how it was. Praise God. Hallelujah. I'm giving you some more modern as well as some of the things that happened in the past. Because you probably weren't alive in the 1600s, but you sure might have been alive in the 1960s and 70s and 1950s. Hallelujah. Most Baptists are evangelical and very missionary-minded. It will be remembered that the Baptists in England formed the earliest modern mission societies in 1792 and sent out William Carey to India. The adoption of Baptist views by Adoniram Judson and Luther Rice while on the way to Burma led to the organization of the Baptist General Missionary Convention in 1814. Another major separation took place in 1845. When the Southerners seceded from the Northern Baptists to form their own Southern Baptist Convention. The primary issues were slavery and denominational structure rather than doctrine. Oh yeah, politics got in it. Social class status got in it. Mm-hmm. And morality really got it wrong. Because guess what? Northern Baptists were against slavery and Southern Baptists were for slavery. And my God, Southern Baptist Church really has a lot to repent for. Yeah. Baptists established strong fundamental doctrines, but were not as involved in the holiest part of the movement as the Methodists were. The Baptist general beliefs are the basic truths upon which the majority of the holiness and Pentecostal churches were built. While Baptist groups differ in certain minor details, they are generally agreed upon the following principles of faith: the inspiration and trustworthiness of the Bible as the sole rule of life, the lordship of Jesus Christ, the inherent freedom of the individual to approach God for himself, the granting of salvation through faith by way of grace and contact with the Holy Spirit, two ordinances, the Lord's Supper and baptism of believers by immersion, the independence of the local church, the church as a group of regenerated believers baptized upon confession of faith, infant baptism as unscriptural and not to be practiced, complete separation of church and state, the immortality of the soul, the brotherhood of man, the royal law of God, the need of redemption from sin, and the ultimate triumph of God's kingdom. Basically, the 18 articles of faith. Yes, the Baptist Church has 18 articles of faith, and if you bother to read it, trust me, I had to know them before I got ordained. For I was ordained May 30th, 2003. I was ordained at the Pine Grove Missionary Baptist Church, the church where everybody is somebody. Under the prophet of God, Reverend Dr. De Broglie, one time. Methodist. Now, my grandfather and my great uncles and great aunts were Methodists. Listen. On my grandmother's, on my mother's side, they generally are Methodists. You got some that are Pentecostal, some that are charismatic, but most of the time for the Ernst and the Farley and Martin side of the family, which is my mother's side, they are Methodists. John Wesley is recognized as the founder of Methodism. Methodism was an extension of Philip Jacob Spinner's teaching in his Pia Desideria, 1675, which became known as Pietism. Spinner taught that a genuine Christian life begins with conscious awareness of forgiveness of sin and a witness of the Spirit, that one is adopted into God's family. If you read the book of Romans chapter 8 and the book of Galatians chapter 4, you will see that we are adopted. Hallelujah. He believed that the experience of justification by faith must be balanced by a dedicated and obedient life. To maintain purity of motive, the believer should refrain from any activities that might lead into sinful acts. Influenced by the Puritans of Strasbourg, he recommended abstaining from popular amusements and moderation in both food and dress. The Pietist truce sparked the Moravian revival of 1727. In Great Britain, this revival was preceded by 3 weeks of constant group prayer. 3 weeks after the revival began, a prayer chain was started that lasted 100 years. People were filled with the Spirit, and spontaneous prophecy and spiritual song became common. Within 25 years, 100 Moravian missionaries had been sent to foreign countries, more than all Protestantism had produced in 2 centuries. Moravian missionaries were instrumental in the conversion of John and Charles Wesley, who inherited his doctrinal emphases from the Pietists and Moravians. In his earlier years, John Wesley studied at Christ Church, Oxford. While there, he helped form the Holy Club, of which George Whitfield was a fellow member. Because of the habit of being methodical in Bible study, prayer, and Christian religious practices, they came to be known as the Methodists. John graduated from Oxford and was ordained to the Anglican ministry, which means they call it the Episcopal Church in America. Okay. However, according to John and Charles Wesley, they did not receive their born-again experience until May 1738. It occurred in a Moravian society meeting on Aldersgate Street in London. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Lay preachers and gospel singing. The unique doctrines of John Wesley and Methodism have already been presented. However, 2 additional contributions of Methodism should be noted. First, John Wesley was one of the first church leaders to use lay preachers to promote the gospel. Previously, the only men ordained to the ministry were those with seminary and university degree. See? And most preachers are lay preachers. they just knew they were called of God, and they did not see the need to go to seminary, Bible college, or even a Bible institute. And some of them, they were known as country, we used to call them country preachers back in the day. It was the lay preachers who took the Protestant holiness movement gospel to the wild frontiers of America. And many holiness groups and denominations were eventually established during the next 150 years by these men. For this reason, some holiness groups developed an attitude of anti-education for the ministry. Some groups still feel formal Bible college training can hinder the flow of the Spirit for anointed preaching. A second contribution of Methodism was gospel singing. John Wesley was the vibrant preacher, but Charles Wesley was the singer. He wrote over 6,000 hymns, 4,000 of which were published. What John preached, Charles put to song. Singing became a co-laborer with preaching for the salvation of souls and the building up of the church. There are numerous and various brands of the present-day Methodism, and they vary from the very liberal doctrine and living to the old holiness doctrine. Now you got folks who's ashamedly they're so far left that they don't really want to. They made a social gospel, and then you got folks who's so far right they don't want to deal with the caring of the poor. They look down their nose at folks. And my question is, who are you? Who are you? Did you go to the cross for me? No. Well, sit down and repent of your pride, your prideful self. Christian and Missionary Alliance. Albert Benjamin Simpson, no relationship, at least as far as I know, founded the Alliance Church. He was a Canadian of Scottish background, educated at Knox College, Toronto. Fresh out of college, called in 1865 to become pastor of the Knox Presbyterian Church, Hamilton, Ohio. During 9 years in this church, 750 members were received into communion. Near the close of the year in 1873, he entered upon a new charge, the Chestnut Street Presbyterian Church in Louisville, Kentucky. He promoted a revival and the building of a new church. During the revival under the ministry of Major D.W. Whittle and the singing of P.P. Bliss, A.B. Simpson came into a new Christian experience, the fullness of the blessing of Christ, or sanctification through faith in the provision of the atonement, and served the church in Louisville with success until 1880, when he resigned to accept a call to the 13th Street Presbyterian Church, New York City. If I can make it there, I can make it anywhere. Truth of divine healing illuminated. Albert Simpson's new experience revolutionized his Christian life. With his tremendous zeal for the Lord, he soon overworked himself, causing his already unhealthy body to give out completely. The doctors gave him only a few months to live. It was during this time he searched the scriptures in regard to the nature of man, the nature of sin, and our position as believers in Christ. He saw man as consisting of a twofold nature. He saw him as both being a material and spiritual being. Both areas had been equally affected by the fall. His body was corrupted by disease, and his soul was corrupted by sin. Through Simpson's intensified study of the scripture, the Holy Spirit illuminated his mind with the reality that Jesus had made provision for divine healing of bodily ailments, just as he had for the forgiveness of sins. With that revelation and conviction, Simpson's faith laid hold of the promise of God. Previously, he had been taught that by whose stripes you were healed in 1 Peter 2:24, and other scriptures were only for the healing of man's sinful soul. But now he realized it was also for the healing of the body. God confirmed his revelation and faith by supernaturally healing his body and by extending his ministry for another 35 years. Look at God. Go ask Hezekiah about that, y'all. The king, go read Go read the book of Kings and the book of Chronicles and come upon the life of Hezekiah. Study Hezekiah's life and see how the Lord physically healed him. Simpson edited the Alliance Weekly and wrote more than 70 books. His principles of divine healing are contained in his book, The Gospel of Healing. The basic doctrines of the Missionary Alliance Church are summarized in what he called the fourfold gospel: Jesus Christ as Savior, Sanctifier, Healer, and Coming King. The church moves on. The Holy Spirit brought forth a man with a message that caused a restorational movement. It restored another truth to the body of Christ, which brought more of Christ's complete redemption into the church and took the eternal church one step closer to its ultimate redemption of spirit, soul, and body. Every restorational truth raises the faith level of the body of Christ. The last truth to be restored to the mortal church will raise his faith to the level of overcoming the last enemy of the eternal church. Other mainline holiness churches. Literally hundreds of churches originated in the years between 1600 and 1900. Every mainline restorational church developed doctrinal statements based on the old Catholic Apostles' Creed and the doctrines of the Protestant movement, plus whatever phrase of the Holiness movement it accepted. Some groups developed unique traits. For instance, the Church of Christ denomination opposed the use of any instrumental music in church worship. They also originated to say where to speak where the Bible speaks and be silent where the Bible is silent, which is a big mistake. Each faith feels it is God's favorite. Most holiness groups seem to virtually all Christian denominations disclaim being a denomination. Each group normally develops some minor doctrinal definition of truth and some practices that made them feel that they were the true church, God's elected, selected, called out, faithful followers, the bride of Christ. Many claim apostolic succession or claim that their heritage goes back to the early church and the apostles. Some Baptists go all the way back to John the Baptist. Nearly every group tried to pick what it believed the most authentic biblical name. The name Church of God is mentioned several times in Scripture. For that reason, over 200 independent holiness churches chose the name Church of God in one form or another. Non-mainline churches usually classified as cults. The major groups originating during this time were the Unitarian, Universalist, Christian Science, Seventh-day Adventist, Mormon Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, Jehovah's Witnesses, Swedenborg Church, Spiritualist, and some other groups. Most were started by Protestant and Holiness preachers who added some supposedly scriptural practices or teachings to their holiness truths. These additions were erroneous enough to separate them from the mainstream of restorational truth. We're not classifying them as restorational churches. They branched off and cut away from the mainstream and became spiritual bayou and miry places. Other mighty men of the movement. The most prominent men and women of the holiness movement were Jonathan Edwards, George Whitfield, Philip Jacob Spencer, A.G. Spangenberg, Count von Zinzendorf, Howell Harris, George Fox, Blaise Pascal, Charles G. Finney, Charles Harrison Spurgeon, Billy Sunday, Dwight L. Moody, Francis J. Fanny J. Crosby, she wrote many wonderful hymns, and William Booth. There were hundreds and thousands of others, and only heaven has them properly recorded and can give them just recognition and rewards. These men and women have joined the great cloud of witnesses who have finished their race and fulfilled the will of God for their generation. They're waiting for us to fulfill the restored truth for our generation. The last day church will fulfill the final details and restore the last truth, thereby inviting the second coming of Jesus, uniting all members of the body of Christ through the church age. All heaven is depending on each generation to fulfill its work of restoration. Nothing thrills heaven more that for the members of Christ's body to be established in all restorational truth and to fulfill the present truth for the generation. See 2 Peter 1 and 12 and Revelation 6, 10 through 11. You have to walk in present truth. You have to walk in present truth. Isms and world events. The main isms outside the holiness movement that affected Christendom were deism, rationalism, modernism, intellectualism, humanism, atheism, communism, and Darwinism. Most of these beliefs are still a curse within the public schools in the United States and many other nations. Some world events during this time were America was colonized mainly by Christians seeking religious freedom, the American Revolution and its independence in 1776 as a self-governing nation, the French Revolution, the European Wars, European colonization of India, Africa, and Australia, and the American Civil War and abolishment of slavery, the Industrial Revolution, and the increase in scientific knowledge led to many new inventions. Those that affected communications and travel were the stagecoach, James Watt's steam engine, steamships, railroads, electricity, the telegraph, telephone, and newspapers. The expansion of the church. Each time a restorational movement brought a deeper revelation and understanding of biblical truths, the Holy Spirit also moved on believers to bring the existing truths to a greater number of people. Thus, an increase in the quality of the church resulted in an increase in the quantity of the church. The Protestant movement coincided with the time when explorers were crossing the oceans to discover new lands and routes. Although many went out seeking main material wealth, some went with a desire to extend the gospel of Christ to other people and lands. During the holiness movement, the idea of missions were revolved. Rather than just believing that the heathen must not be predestined to go to heaven, people began to see the Great Commission, see Mark 16, 15, as a responsibility of believers. You got to go out and tell somebody that Jesus died for you and rose again. Somewhere along the line, you got to preach Christ and him crucified. Somewhere along the line, yes, Lord, you got to go out and tell somebody that Jesus saves. God used William Carey to help challenge the church to actively seek to evangelize the lost. Missionaries settled in many of the coastal lands of the world, including those of India, South Africa, and China. They also spread across North America from the Eastern Seaboard to the Pacific Ocean. So yes, there is national missionaries, national apostles. We go out and work the land. Yes, we do. The holiness movement summarized. The purpose of the holiness movement was to restore the second doctrine of Christ, faith toward God, to the eternal church. It was conceived in Europe, built in, but America became the place of its birth and growth to maturity. The men were numerous. John Wesley is the man most noted for promoting holiness. The people who participated in these ministers propagated the truth came from the Protestant movement, churches. The message was threefold: believers' baptism by immersion, sanctification, and divine healing. The ministry was preaching of the word, accompanied by special singers, great conviction, blessings, and physical manifestations of the emotions and healings. The products that carried the message to the end of the earth were the steamship and railroad. Glory to God. The message was threefold: believers' baptism by immersion, sanctification, and divine healing. The ministry was preaching of the word, accompanied by special singers, great conviction, blessings, and physical manifestations of emotions and healing. The products that carried the message to the ends of the earth were the steamship and railroad. Christ came in holiness truth to take the world out of the church in preparation for his personal coming, to take the church out of the world. The result was that the eternal church crossed its Red Sea of what? Water baptism, became sanctified and separated from the world, and journeyed out, journeyed on to receive Christ's redemption work of divine healing. The second giant step was taken by the church in its restoration walk to its Canaan land to fulfill maturity in Christ. Now, praise the name of the Lord. What are the tenets of faith? In fact, what is the definition of a tenet? Hallelujah. The definition of a tenet is a principle or belief, especially one of the main principles of a religion or philosophy. Amen. It's a principle. So you must be what? Fixed on principles and flexible on plans. Guess what? So if you don't know the principles of the faith, then guess what? You out there. Now, number one, who is the founder of our faith is Jesus Christ himself. Between AD 30, AD, year of our Lord. Anno Domini. Okay. So, if a Bible-believing church will have these as their basics. I'm just going to give you the basics. The basics, the scriptures, the scriptures, the Bible, that's the book for me. The Bible is the infallible word of God, period. Exclamation point, matter of fact, with a few underlines and a couple more exclamation points behind that. According to 2 Corinthians 3:16 and 17, it says all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly equipped for all good works. 2 Peter 1:20 through 21 states, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in olden times by the will of man, not by the will of man. Man's will ain't got nothing to do with this. Your reasonings, your desires, no. What you say you will not, yeah, get out the way, man, and let God's will take place. But holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. The true and living God. God is creator and sustainer of all things, revealed in three persons, but one God. As God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. You can find this in Genesis 1:1. For those of you who think it's not three persons, let me say, I'm going to speak just a touch of Hebrew. Just a touch. I'm going to say Genesis 1:1 in Hebrew. Barashit bara Elohim. Haaretz. Hashamayim. What did I just say? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the word Elohim there is plural for God. Plural. But one God, yes, but he's three distinct persons. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Why do you think Jesus said in Matthew 28:19, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit? That's distinction. But unity at the same time. I know it's mind-blowing. Mind-blowing decisions causes head-on collisions. Yes, Lord. John, also Genesis 1:26. God said, let us. He didn't say just let me. He said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness. So either God line or you line. The divine counsel found in Psalm, in the book of Psalms, meet. Guess what the divine counsel is made up of? God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. Holy Spirit, same person. Same person. Love them for. What other scriptures are Hebrews 1:8? The Bible says, unto the Son, the Father speaking, unto the Son, he says, thy throne, O God, is a scepter of righteousness forever. Forever. Forever, ever. Forever, ever. Revelation 1:8 says that he is the first and the last. Alpha and Omega. Go argue with Jesus. I didn't say it. He did. First John 5:7, close this portion out, says, for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, or the Holy Ghost. And these three are one, depending on the translation you're reading. I'm going to tell you, King James, New King James, and the Amplified have that scripture there. Other translations might not. But you want to keep it there. Keep it there. Keep it right there. Keep it right there. Keep it right there. Thank you, Luther. Jesus Christ is the complete God-man, fully God and fully man. He has always existed, John 1, Genesis 1:3. And God said, John 1:1, Gospel of John chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In the Greek, it says this, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and God was the Word. John is preaching. is the Apostle John. He ought to know. He wrote it, and he wrote. Yeah, he was one of them three that was around Jesus all the time. Philippians 2:5-11 talks about this. I'm telling you, we're going through the tenets of faith because you got to know what you believe and why you believe. Preach on, Sean. Oh, I think I will. Go ahead, Apostle. Titus 2:13 calls Jesus our great God. Say, how are you going to get around that one? I don't know. He was born of the Virgin Mary in Matthew chapter 1, verses 23-25, Luke 1:26-36. Galatians 4:4. He was crucified. Now, when I used to read the Bible and I got to the time part of the crucifixion of Christ, I would shed tears because of all the love that I was feeling because he took it. Diane McCurkin has a beautiful song called Just For Me. I might play it today. Just For Me. Jesus came and did it. Just For Me. Hallelujah. Mark 15:42-47. Mark comes like 15:16-41. Luke 23:50-56, and John 19:17-30. He was buried. Matthew 27:57-61. I'm giving you the scriptures. Go research. Don't search them out for yourself. I'm not saying it's true. Luke 23:50-54. I'm sorry. Buried. Matthew 27:57-61. Mark 15:42-47. Luke 23:50-51. 54, I'm sorry. John 19:38-42. He is resurrected. Oh, praise God that he's risen. I gotta stop just giving some praise right now. Just wave my hand. Sometimes I just can't say a word. And the Lord knows exactly what I'm talking about. Hallelujah. Matthew 28:5-6. Mark 16:1-6. Luke 24:1-7. And John 20:8 and verses 12-20. He ascended into heaven, Mark 16:19, Luke 24:50-51, Acts 1:9-11. My eyes playing tricks on me. 1 Timothy 3:16. Will return. Matthew 24:27 and verse 37. Acts 1:10-11. 1 Thessalonians 4:15-18. And chapter 5, verse 2. Titus 2:13, and Revelation 1:7. He is the baptizer with the Holy Spirit. Matthew 3 and 11, Luke 3 and 16. The Holy Spirit, He is God. Genesis 1 1. And verse 26. Acts 5, 3 through 4. And chapter 13, 1 through 3. He has all the attributes of God. He's omnipresent, Psalm 139, 7 through 12. Omnipotent, Zechariah 4, 6. Omniscient, 1 Corinthians 2, 10 through 11. He is the giver of gifts. 1 Corinthians 12, 11, and verse 28. He builds His character in believers, Romans 14, 17, and Galatians 5, 22 through 23. Angels, the Bible uses the term angels, a heavenly body, clearly and primarily to note messengers or ambassadors of God, with such scripture references as Revelation 4, 5, which indicates their duty in heaven to praise God, Psalm 103 and 20, to do God's will, Matthew 18, 10, and to behold His face. But since heaven must come down to earth, they also have a mission to earth. The Bible indicates that they accompany God in creation, and also that they will accompany Christ in His return in glory. Satan and demons. Jesus, thank you. Oh, hallelujah. But since heaven must also have come down, since heaven must come down to earth, they also have a mission to the earth. The Bible indicates they accompany God in the creation, and also that they will accompany Christ in His return in glory. Also, one of the things they minister, the last verse in Hebrews chapter 1 tells you the ministry of angels to believers. It says that they are ministering spirits to those who will inherit salvation. Praise the name of the Lord. Satan and demons. Demons denote unclean or evil spirits. They are sometimes called devils or demonic beings. They are evil spirits belonging to the unseen or spiritual realm embodied in human beings. The Old Testament refers to the prince of demons, sometimes called Satan, adversary, or devil, as having power and wisdom, taking the habitation of other forms such as the serpent, Genesis 3:1. The New Testament speaks of the devil as tempter, Matthew 4 and 3. And it goes on to tell the works of Satan, the devil, and demons as combating righteousness and good in any form, proving to be an adversary to the saints. The chief power is exercised to destroy the mission of Jesus Christ. It can be well said that the Christian church believes in demons, Satan, and devils. We believe in their power and purpose. We believe that they can be subdued and conquered, as in the commandment to the believer by Jesus, in my name. They shall cast out Satan and the work of the devil, and to resist him, and then he will flee, withdraw from you. Mark 16, 17. Man was created holy by God, composed of spirit, soul, and body. Genesis 1, 26 through 28, let us make man in our image. Imago Dei is the Latin. In the Hebrew, Adam, say what we spell Adam, Adam. A-D-A-M, it's a Hebrew word meaning man. Praise the name of the Lord. 1 Thessalonians 5:23. We read that man by nature is sinful and unholy. Being born in sin, he needs to be born again, sanctified and cleansed from all sin by the blood of Jesus. We read that man is saved by confessing and forsaking his sins. Romans 10:9-10, cross-reference 1 John 1:9. And believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, and that having become a child of God by being born again, John 3:3 and verse 7 both say, ye must be born again. Disciples, your spiritual formation is evangelism. If you're an apostle, you're also an evangelist. Because guess what? Even Paul, great apostle Paul, Peter, all got folks saved. Whether you're apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, or teacher, your role as an ambassador for Christ is, guess what? Get people saved. That's the work of the ministry. It's the main work. The book of Luke, chapter 11, verse 23. You will find these words. I'm sorry, 14:23. And the Lord said unto the servant, go out into the highways and hedges and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. Proverbs 11 talks about he that winneth souls is wise. That's your rank. That's the first thing. After you get saved, you're supposed to go get somebody else. And just like the old shampoo commercial, and they'll tell two friends, and they'll tell two friends, and so on and so on and so on. What are you saying, preacher? Let me tell you. Restoration has come. Pastor Calvin, what up, fam? God bless you. Glad to see you. Hallelujah. Pastor Calvin Mitchell, hallelujah. The link to come into the Zoom is there. We're talking about the tenets of faith right now. We went through the holiness movement during the History of Christianity 101, but I really want to hear you, my dear friend, hallelujah, and brother in the Lord, hallelujah. I know you might be on the truck still, so, but in the link, if you, hallelujah. We're talking about the tenets of faith. We've gone through the scriptures, the true and living God, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, angels, demons, which includes Satan. And now we're dealing with the doctrine of man. Hallelujah. We believe that man is saved by confessing and forsaking his sins. And we believe that man is saved by confessing and forsaking his sins. According to Romans 10:9-10, which says, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. When you read the word shall, will, or in King James English, shalt and wilt, guess what? That means it's going to happen. It got to happen. For with the heart, man believeth unto righteousness. And with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. You are not, guess what? You are not able to save yourself. You can't do it. You can't heal yourself. You can't save yourself. Why? Because you got a sinful nature. So you need to go to the one who never sinned a day in his life. You have to go there. Your first role is your first role as a believer. To do the work of a ministry, of the ministry, is soul winning. Proverbs 11 says that he that winneth souls is wise. Want some wisdom? Start winning some souls. I guarantee you get some wisdom. In the holiness movement, which we talked about, people were literally weeping, crying out, because they wanted to be free from worldliness. Now think about that. A man, I said it before, I'm saying it again. A man read a sermon called Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. And the anointing was so powerful on it, the whole church was weeping. And people were coming up to the altar getting saved. The Bible says godly sorrow does what? Brings about repentance. So if you're not sorry for your sins, guess what? No, repentance won't come. By the way, repentance must be granted by God. Read your Bible. Hallelujah. And adopted into the family of God. Yes, there is an adoption. According to Romans 8:15, the Lord has sent the Spirit, God has sent the Spirit of adoption into our hearts of the Son, by which we cry out, what? Abba, Father. Read your Bible. It's repeated again in Galatians chapters 4, 5 through 6. We'll read that just in case people think I'm just playing. Galatians chapter 4. Hallelujah. Verses 5 and 6. Says these words. You'll find these words. To redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And because ye are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Well, the Bible says out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, let every word be established. Can I get a witness there, Pastor? Uh-huh. Yes, Lord. I need a little amen corner tonight. Hallelujah. Even though Lord, I believe the Lord is pleased. He may and should claim the inheritance of the sons of God. According to the book of Ephesians chapter 1, Paul prays a prayer in Ephesians chapter 1 that we can all pray for one another. And that what? That we would receive, that we may know the inheritance we have. Now, and to get it verbatim, I'm going to read it. Ephesians chapter 1. By the Hebrews, hallelujah. Ephesians chapter 1, listen. I'm going to start for context with verse 15. Wherefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling and what are the riches. Did you hear that? The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling, and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. Now that's what the word say. Go argue with, y'all go argue with the Lord. I did not write it. He says you have an inheritance. You can claim it too. Which is namely what? The baptism of the Holy Spirit, Acts chapter 1 and 5, but ye shall read, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Again, go argue with the Lord. For those of y'all don't think that's for today, well, my Bible tells me in Romans 11, 29 that the gifts and callings of God are without repentance. Another translation would say irrevocable. When God gives you something, he don't take it away. It's there whether you use it or not. Go ask the man who was given the talent. And then find out, the Bible says he buried the talent. The other two worked with the talents they were given. And the other one buried it. That's foolishness. And he found out it was foolishness too. The rapture. Uh-oh, I know this is going to be controversial. The pre-tribulational, pre-millennial view is the proper scriptural view. 1 Corinthians 15, 51 through 52, 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 through 18, Revelation 1, 6, and chapter 20, verses 1 through 6. Four affirmations provide a biblical framework for the pre-tribulational rapture. They are one, consistent literal interpretation. Two, premillennialism. Three, futurism. And four, a distinction between Israel and the church. The church did not replace Israel. Read Romans 11 if you thought it did. Then go read Revelation. And when you find out all them Jewish folk from the 12 tribes of Israel, we're going to be out here evangelizing what the churches has been raptured away, then you tell me if it is or it's not a separate program. These are not mere suppositions, but rather are important biblical doctrines upon which the doctrine of the rapture is built. Premillennialism teaches that the second advent will occur before Christ's thousand-year reign upon earth from Jerusalem. Revelation 19, 11 through chapter 20, verse 6. Why? Because number one, the Bible says every eye will see him. Number two, while the apostles in chapter 1 in the book of Acts and chapter 11 in the book of Acts, chapter 23 in the book of Luke, was up there waving bye-bye to Jesus. So the angels had to come down and tell him, hey, look here, the same Jesus who went away in the cloud gonna come back to you the same way. Look, we ain't got time to be waving bye-bye to Jesus. Number one, because guess what? He takes residence in our heart. He says, if any man, behold, I stand at the door and what? Nah. If any man answer, I will come to him, and my father and I will make our abode with him and in him and sup with him. So guess what? We got to be dealing with some things here. Either you lying or Jesus is lying. I did not call Jesus, who is God, a liar. Eternal judgment. The Bible teaches there are two different judgments. One for believers, 2 Corinthians 5, 10, and one for unbelievers, Revelation 20, 11 through 15. It is taught in the Gospels, Matthew 18 and 8. It is one of the six doctrines according to Hebrews 6, 1 and 2, which states, therefore, leaving the discussion of the elementary principles of Christ, let us go on to perfection. and not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and a faith toward God, of the doctrine of baptisms, of laying on of hands, a resurrection of the dead, and of eternal judgment. Now, in verse 3 is not in there, but it says, then this we will do if God permit. How many people are teaching the six doctrines of Christ? Most elementary doctrines. Before you get in the meat, you got to give them the milk. And the milk are found, the milk of the word, of the doctrine of Christ, Christology, if you will, is taught in Hebrews chapter 6, verses 1 through 2. And once you get those six doctrines down in your heart, and let it become rhema to you. That's why I say you got to know what you believe and why you believe. And as an apostle of Jesus Christ, I am appalled that people don't know the basic doctrines of our faith. The tenets, we gave you the definition of tenets before. Tenets mean to what? Which are our principles. We are flexible on plans, fixed on principles. What does that mean? That means you don't change your principles for nobody. Your plans might change. God bless you, Sister Gia. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank God for you. Gia XO. Hallelujah. We're following you already, so thankful that we welcome you to History of Christianity and Discipleship Formation in Spiritual Ranking. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Now, I want to hear from you, because I'm that kind of person who likes that feedback. All right. So give me a little feedback, Pastor Kelvin, on what you just heard, if you're available to speak.
I'm just thinking about repentance. Yeah, repentance is a key, right? You got to repent. You got to, and the other one, the Hebrew letter or something like that, I read all of them. It means to go turn around, to go away from what you were doing. So I enjoy that. Also, wrong about the Hebrew term or letter, whatever, about repentance. But yeah, repentance is a big key.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people want to skip over repentance and keep doing what they want to do. But also, but you can't do that. So everything you're speaking is true. Everything you're speaking is true about repentance, about talents. You know, a lot of people, I was just thinking while you were talking, but before I got on, you said something about talents. A lot of people complain about church so much they forget about what God has given them. They church hurt. I was like, forget about church hurt. What about your talents? Why are you somewhere so God can use you? I hear my mic.
Outstanding. Without seeing, according to the word of God, you use your gifts, time, and talents for him. You can tithe your time if you don't have money. You can tithe your time, which is 2 hours and 25 minutes a day. 2.4. It was 2.5. If it was 2.5, then it would be 2 hours and 30 minutes a day. All right. So, with that being stated, if you give the Lord that much time in a day, and then anything over is an offering of your praise, your devotion time, whatever you want to give the Lord. Now, You, number one, you cannot live any kind of way you want to. Now you make that deathbed confession and you see the Lord Jesus Christ on your deathbed, hey. There's a Lord. The Lord is a God of mercy. But he's also a God of holiness. He's a holy God. So you have to repent. You got to admit that you were a sinner first. And once you admit that you were a sinner, you can get somewhere. That means you need a savior. And how do we get there? You repent of your sins and you ask the Lord. The Bible says the prayer of faith shall save the sin. And if he has committed any sins, it will be forgiven. Again, go argue with the Lord. I didn't write it. Your first thing in spiritual ranking, after you learn those six tenets, those principles of Christ, then you got to start getting some wisdom. And that comes through winning souls. Then, guess what? Holiness, the holiness movement, boy, they were some caught on fire churches. You had folks, you had healing, physical healing going on. Well, you can't do that unless the Holy Spirit gives you the gifts of healing. I'm just saying. Second, there was speaking in tongues during these times. Even in the Baptist churches in the 1600s, they had speaking in tongues. Folks were shouting. People were weeping because of repentance. Godly sorrow leads to what? Repentance. And that started what we call what's called the Baptist churches. I'm an old Baptist boy, so I know. And we had to talk about the Methodist churches, the Christian and Missionary Alliance churches. We talked about men like Charles G. Finney, Maria Wordsworth Eder, Fanny J. Crosby, who wrote many a hymn that we still sing today. Let's see how many songs we sing by her today. Hallelujah. She wrote over 8,000 hymns. To God be the glory. You sing that. Old Rugged Cross. I know we know that. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the place of suffering and shame. Oh, I know every church, especially in what we call so the black church, sing, "Pass me not, O gentle Savior." Whether we do the upbeat version or the slower version, we know the song. You know, different arrangements. Just think, that's just some of these songs. But there are more. Draw me near, redeem. Tell them all that I've been redeemed, bought with a price. Are you redeemed today? But everybody know, pass me not, O gentle Savior, and O worthy cross. But she wrote 8,000 of them. But those two specifically, I know, are some. And let me tell you something. According to the scripture, that's one of the signs of being filled with the Holy Spirit. And according to the Bible, there's three signs of being filled with the Holy Spirit. Number one, you speak in tongues. Number two, you speak the word of God with boldness. Finally, you speak to one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. So either the Bible lying or you lying. Sister Doris, God bless you. Always good to see you. I want you to think about something. And Pastor Kelvin, don't go getting out there shouting. After I play this song, I know my brother. He might just shout. Just tell me who God is. Hallelujah. It's going to take you back a little bit. It's going to take you back just a little bit. Hallelujah. Imani, God bless you. Oh, Hands and worship for a Hallelujah. Now, Pastor Kelvin, I am not responsible if you are up there shouting and got to pull over and dance your step. And don't blame me. Blame God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All right, all right. Well, if everything being stated, anybody want to talk about holiness before I close the room? The holiness of God. I'll take that as a no. Hallelujah. I'll render the blessing. May the Lord bless thee and keep thee and cause his face to shine upon thee. Hallelujah. The Lord. Hallelujah, be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee his peace. Now, may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, love of God, and the sweet communion of the Holy Ghost rest, rule, and abide with you both now and forever. Amen. Go in peace, peace, peace from the Prince of Peace. Next. Tomorrow, meet me here at 6 o'clock. 6 o'clock. We're going to be doing our prayer net. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Y'all be blessed.